Namaste and welcome. You are watching Program Discourse and I am your host Nimliki Sharpa. Today we have invited Dr. Chen. He is a Director of International Studies, Zhongyang Institute of Redmond University of China. He has been working in different research work as well as different projects related to China and other international sectors. So I would like to welcome him. Hello, sir. Namaste and welcome
Hello.
To our source.
Hello, namaste. Namaste. It's my pleasure to be in your program, and also it's also my pleasure to say namaste to all of the Nepali audience here.
So I would like to begin without any formalities. I would like to begin through the questions. Nowadays, especially and currently, One Belt and One Road is very very huge and famous project. What is the main motto of this project?
One Belt One Road, or the as the official name is the Belt and Road Initiatives, means that the Silk Road Economic Belt and the 21st Century Maritime Silk Road, and it was proposed by the Chinese government around 4 years ago. Actually, one of the aim is that to achieve common development through international development. So common development is the objective or the final goals of these initiatives. And also international cooperation is a major means or a major approach or the way to achieve that goal. So why in this time or at this stage the Chinese government would like to raise or come up with these ideas of Belt and Road initiatives to achieve the common development? I think what the reason or the major reason behind is that now we come to a very difficult time when the old outdated globalization has come to an end, and also the new more inclusive globalization which work for all of the countries, especially the developing countries, has not yet to come. So I think in this stage it's a right moment for a country like China to raise the new globalization, but which is different from the World Bank or IMF-led old globalization. This new era globalization will focus on inclusive development. Inclusive development means that the development for all of the people. So that's number one. Number two is that we are facing a very very big deficit in development. We also face a big gap between the infrastructure needs and also the infrastructure supply, major primarily by the old institutions, by the established institutions. That's why I think we need to establish the more new institutions to fit the infrastructure needs to fund the new growth. That's why we have AIIB, the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, with both China and India, the largest and the second largest shareholders. And also we have the BRICS, the New Development Bank. Both China and India are inside.
Okay, while we are talking about One Belt and One Road, there may come BRI also.
Right.
So through BRI, it is becoming an more interest for all over the country. And
right.
Do you think it is beneficiary to the developing nations? How it is beneficial to developing nations like Nepal?
Right, especially for our neighborhood. This is now also one of the importance or one of the reasons that to drive the Belt and Road is that we are facing the huge imbalance of development, which means China is more and more developing, and for example we are going the innovation technology, we are moving a quality economy rather than quantity economy, which means we pursue more and more better quality production services and life. So at that stage, you know, we just look at all of our land neighbors. We have 14 land neighbors. You know, all of them actually are less developed than China, and especially, I mean, for our neighbors, for example, Nepal. You know, if we compare the per capita GDP, or if we compare the human development index, which is adopted by the United Nations, we can see it's a huge imbalance, where it's a huge gap. That's why it's where China would like to share our development bonus with our neighbors, especially our close friends as well as neighbors. And I believe Nepal is a very important part, and also it's where the Belt and Road can start. So it's specifically for Nepal, I think 2 years ago, actually it's the spring 2015, I think all of the three countries, China, Nepal, and India, they you know, proposed the China-Nepal-India Economic Corridor, which is which was formerly a part of the Belt and Road Initiative. Of course, now we all know that India has its own concerns, even some might say objections toward the Belt and Road. But I think still, even without India, of course, I mean, we would like to see, right, we warmly welcome India to be part of that, to co-build China-Nepal-India Economic Corridor. But even without that, I think we have already, I mean, bilaterally, I mean, China and Nepal has already signed an MOU on co-building Belt and Road in this May, before the Belt and Road Forum for International Cooperation. So specifically for Nepal, some pillars are very important. For example, infrastructure, especially after earthquake reconstruction, is where China is continue to help, and also is where we can build up the base for industries. And also tourism should be encouraged, as also it's also part of Belt and Road, especially in terms of people to people connections, connectivity. And also we must encourage the trade investment. It's a trade connectivity and the investment connectivity. And above all, we need to have a better policy connectivity, which means both countries, I mean both governments, should be devoted to implement what we have achieved as agreements develop. And in the Nepalese context, I think the poverty alleviation is one of the key areas. So that's also where we can start. But I mean, how to achieve this poverty reduction or poverty alleviation? I believe for urban areas, I mean the urban infrastructure, for example, the ring road, and also the key bridge, as the Chinese companies have already been doing, are very important. And for the remote, relatively remote areas, I think there is a very old Chinese saying, if we want to be rich, build a road first. So if we want to be rich very quickly, build a railway. If we want to be rich immediately, build internet or telecommunication. So all of them are very important to that. But of course, I think in the Nepali context, you are asking me the Nepali, what Nepal can benefit from Belt and Road. I mean, it's also
not only Nepal, even like other nations too, which are like still developing nations.
Right, right. I think especially for South Asia, all of the South Asian countries are still lack of development. Even a lot of them are still one of the least developed countries. I have an argument that two types of countries will benefit the Belt and Road most. The type one is landlocked countries, because landlocked country needs infrastructure connectivity very urgently. The second is the least developed countries. So, now we have Nepal, both landlocked countries as well as still by far the least developed country. Then I would say Nepal will benefit from the Belt and Road most. But on the other hand, I would argue that I also encourage my Nepali friends to also to devote or to devote themselves to co-building the Belt and Road, because the Belt and Road, yes, indeed, was proposed by China, but now it belongs to all. It open to all and it belongs to all. Means that it also, yes, it's China's proposal, but also it's Nepalese it's also the Nepalese project.
So we have to, you mean to say you have, we have to feel it is our project?
Of course, and also not only feel that it's your project, it's a Nepalese project, but also Nepal, as well, I mean, both the government, business, and also the people should, you know, participate in the decision making, and all of the decision making is also open to Nepal. For example, I'll give an example. AIIB is going to provide loans in two infrastructure projects. But you know, the way that AIIB, you know, part of the Belt and Road initiatives of financial body is doing is that, okay, the AIIB, after underground research, will provide a manual of list to Nepali government. And then it's the Nepali government's turn to decide how to choose the projects, you know, from all of the menus. So it's like China, Belt and Road is like China is providing a menu. Yeah. We are like a chef or a cook of the Chinese food. We can cook Nepali
food. And we have to have from cooking.
Yes, we have tofu, we have rice, we have momo.
Yeah.
So then it's your turn. It's a customer's turn to decide which one you like. So it's a consulting and co-building process. It's not one way, but two ways, but even
like
many
we are,
ways.
While we are giving the example of cook and safe and consumer, it means like we have to buy or like you are, or we can work together or we can work collaborate, we can collaborate to success this project.
Of course, I mean, it's a win-win situation and also it's a collaborating. For example, I mean, now I think at least one of the two projects is something about the you know, Talai region's in infrastructure development. But again it's the Nepali government's turn to best utilize these resources. It's again is the Nepali government as well as the people's turn to decide when, where, and you know, how to develop those roads, those infrastructure. I think that is again the, you know, it's, I think all of the parties should, it's like a joint venture. It's like a joint venture. Of course, I mean, China is more abundant in technology and the investment and money, and then of course China will contribute a lot as the largest share. But also I think all of the people, for example, the Nepali people, is also part of that. You are also shareholders in the whole Belt and Road. So let me ask us your opinion, what you want and what you would like to choose, and in what way you would like to develop those infrastructure, those trade, and also the culture programs.
Okay. So while we are talking about different project initiated by the China government, there come another project also, like which is Beijing Lhasa Keelung to Kathmandu, which
right.
is trend project. How it is ambitious project, and how it will be completed?
Right. Yes, you are right. I mean, it's a very ambitious plan. Actually, this plan has come up with an idea that it will be an extension of our Qinghai-Tibet Railway further west forward, you know, from Zhigaza through Keelung or Keelung, and then linking with Kathmandu, even further southward, linking with Bihar Pradesh, and then where the whole Indian railway network can be linked with the west extension of the Qinghai Tibet Railway. Of course, we understand now, especially I think in the inner part, is still probably not there, and there is some difficulties in terms of the Indians' attitude toward the Belt and Road.
What kind of difficulties?
Of course, yeah, I mean, Indian, at least the New Delhi is very reluctant to be connected with the Belt and Road. They kind of, because, you know, they didn't participate in the Belt and Road Forum for International Cooperation in this May, and also I think all of the projects, you know, linking India has something lagging behind. So it's a little bit frustrating. But I think despite of the New Delhi's attitude toward the Belt and Road, I think still, I mean, China and Nepal can at least consider to do that. I think at this stage, feasibility studies is very important, because, you know, those areas are very geographically and environmentally, ecologically vulnerable. So that's why I think like very concrete studies on the ground is the key to the success of that issues. And also, I believe it will be very expensive. I believe it could be only commercial viable as long, you know, only if it's linked with the whole Indian railway system. But still, I think the studies can be done, and also in the Nepali, including the Chinese section and the Nepali section, if that's possible in India sections.
Then when it will be completed? Or how can we assume till then maybe it will be finished or something like that?
I think it will depends on first the concrete studies, second the political will, you know, of the all of the three parties, and third the fundings. We would like to see whether AIIB is the right position to provide those long-term loans to this huge projects, because it could be very expensive. Of course, the Indian is the second largest holder. So of course, I mean, still the Indian's opinion toward this railway is quite important.
Okay. Also, while we are not only in the British project, you have an involvement in research also, in deep research also, especially on Trans-Himalayan project. So how it is working, and have you launched any specific specific program, especially in the Himalaya of Nepal?
I think it's very important to deliver this question, because, you know, now because of the very tragic earthquake, I mean, the cast of Dadubani pass, they have a lot of problems. Mm-hmm. And a lot of infrastructure reconstruction are ongoing, but unfortunately, there, you know, in this August, this collapse of the key bridge even made it harder, make it more difficult. So now, you know, Geelong or Keelung pass is the alternative, and still, you know, some people are not used to using that. But of course, I think now is still the most feasible way. And also, if we talk about you know, further railway plans, and I also think that according to some studies, I mean, still Geelung or Keelung pass is the only feasible connection point, you know, between China and Nepal. And of course, I think, you know, Trans-Himalayan cooperation, or in terms of Belt and Road, is not only about infrastructure.
Yeah.
Because it's, some people think, well, your Belt and Road is only about infrastructure. Yes, infrastructure is very important, but I think it's beyond that. You know, for example, the online trading, you know, if we go to Tamil, and so you will see actually a lot of express service is linking Nepal and China, and that people, for example, Chinese tourists, they can come to Nepal and buy a lot of things in Tamil, of course, you know, also in elsewhere, and then ship it to China, which is actually increased the Nepali business people, the small shops income. And also, it's also important that we are talking about those kind of, you know, development issue. But development issue is very sustainable, especially when it comes to Trans-Himalaya. We all know that. So that's why I think the environmental protection research is also very important. You know,
what kind of program, except Belt Road and other, like you already said that we have like other project too. So what kind of program you are launching, or while you are doing research in the Himalaya, what is the worst thing or what we have to do, especially Nepalese people, they have to do for the better life, or let's say better to develop themselves, lifestyle or other things?
That's a very good question. I think first, I think focus is very important. It's focused on development, focused on raise up our income, and also focus on not only infrastructure projects, but all of the projects, hardware or software, which can raise raise the group, raise the growth, and provide jobs for the people. For example, I think the hydropower, for example, the recently agreed Gandaki hydropower can has the potential to provide electricity up to 1,000 megawatts, which is a huge actually relatively, and also it's also very important to focus on the implementation of what we have achieved, because actually we have already talked a lot. I mean, especially this time I see in Nepal and more people talk about Belt and Road or OBOR, One Belt One Road, it's the same things. And I also see, I think especially this year, a lot of events, seminars, people talk about it, in media, in a lot of occasions. But only talking, is not enough. To implement, what we have agreed is very important. So I think that is number two. Third, I think we, to achieve a common development, of course, we must have a consensus, and also we need to do the things, in a practical way. For example, if the environment or if the situation changes, I would say the priorities can be subjected to change. So just just as I think one of the Chinese leaders Deng Xiaoping said, no matter black or yellow, a good cat is the cat that catch mice. So I would say, of course, we have a lot of agreements, but I think to implement is very important, and sometimes to be flexible is also very important.
Okay, we are like, I would like to begin another issue. Like it is personally, I think it is not an issue. It is like public interest. I should say public interest. So as an expert and international relation fellow, how do you observe like CPC 19th convention? What is the main outcome of this convention? How do you analyze? What is the main outcome?
Yes.
From this convention?
Well, actually, I started to fly to Nepal even when the Congress,
yeah.
I mean the 19th Congress is still ongoing. But of course, I know some of the context, and one of the key issues is that this Congress focus on identifying the key problems and the key tasks that China is facing. For example, I think the key problem is redefined as the imbalanced and insufficient development. I think that's a big change, because in the past, the articles of the CPC, I mean the constitution of the Communist Party of China,
yeah.
Just identify our main problem is the lack of the productivity, which means, well, if we will produce a lot, and then you can do it. But now I think now these old problems has been largely, to a large extent solved. Especially China was the world factory in the last decades, and especially this couple of years, China become more and more innovative. Now China accounts for nearly 40% of the unicorn. Unicorn is also, it's kind of the index or indicator for innovation startups business. So China has become the world innovation center. So it's not only the world factory, it's even not there. Mm-hmm. So China becomes more, you know, going to innovation technology. Mm-hmm. We are also more and more technological advanced. So it's also our time to redefine what is our problem we are facing. So imbalanced development, that is the imbalance between the East and West in our country. And also it's an imbalance between the urban areas and the rural areas. It's also an imbalance between China and all of our neighboring countries. That's why Belt and Road is very, very important. And you know, especially as one of the key milestones that the Belt and Road Initiative or One Belt One Road has been incorporated into our constitution of the party. So I think that means that the party, the Communist Party of China, is devoted to solve the imbalanced development, including inside China and also outside China.
Mm-hmm. So every people think every people have their different perspective. While we are talking about the Xi Jinping, how do you think about Xi Jinping thought?
Yes, I think Xi Jinping thought is also it's a thought that on the socialist on the socialism with Chinese characteristic in the new era. So what is
new era?
Yes,
new era.
I think that is a key issues. The new era is it comprised with both opportunities and the problems. So I may start with the problems. So the problem is that after the major economic crisis since 2008, well, we have, you know, especially the developed countries has done a lot, but they now face a lot of, you know, problems. You know, we have Mr. Trump in United States who said that United American first. We also see, you know, also the other, you know, the populist trend in Europe, so that, you know, the development there, I mean, especially in developed countries.
So while we are while we are talking about development and leadership in the country, and even in while we are talking about, especially focusing on China,
right.
Even Mao Zedong also do the same things. So have you found any difference between Mao Zedong thoughts and Xi Jinping thoughts?
I would say a lot of thought, because you know, I think the two thoughts just they are in different time. They are different time. For example, the Mao Zedong thoughts basically focus on how to achieve the revolution and how to build a country. So I think that is basically the core ideas of Mao Zedong's thought. However, and Xi Jinping's thought, focused on the new era's opportunities as well as the challenges. So I think both opportunities and the challenges just come from globalization. So opportunities actually comes from globalization, and also the challenges is also from globalization itself, because the old globalization is not balanced. I mean, it's not devoted to long-term development. There are a lot of bodies, for example, IMF, they just focused on the short-term clearance of the money. So that's why it's a time, it's a new time to focus on sustainable development. It's a new time to focus on balanced and common development. So I think that's one of the core of Xi Jinping's thoughts, which just identify our new task, which is to bring about the better life for the people, and also to solve the imbalanced and insufficient development. And also, it's also a new era that China cannot only solve the issues domestically, it's also a time that China is responsible, of course, according to our capacity of providing the so-called international public goods. So international public goods is also one of the characteristic of these new eras. So what is the public goods? I think Belt and Road is one of them.
Okay, so as you are working as a professor as well as researcher, so like we talked about like Mao Zedong thought and Xi Jinping thought. So if you ever get time to compare both of their thoughts, you compare as a same level or like any difference? What do you think?
I think they share some similarities. For example, they focus on the reality, they focus on the real problem. And of course, the Mao Zedong thought is, of course, the problem that Mao Zedong and the early years of Communist Party of China, they faced the task that China was very, very extremely poor, right, during that time. And also China was in a mess. So the state building and to achieve the power and also to eliminate imperialism and also the oppression from the old forces are one of the key tasks of Mao Zedong's era. So but of course I mean serve for the people and identify the people's needs is the core. I think identifying the people's needs and identify what is needs in the specific time or specific era are something the two thoughts shares as similarities. However, I think it's also quite different to see the change. Between Xi Jinping's thoughts on socialism with Chinese characteristic in new era and also his predecessor, because we should be practical and we should focus on the realities and updates. We should focus on the new facts. So I think it's focused on the realities or focused on the real problems are what the two thoughts shares. But also the difference is that of course Xi Jinping thought delivers the problems in this time and also in future. So that's why I think one of the objective of the Xi Jinping thoughts is to achieve the modern development, also to achieve modernization by 2050 and also by two steps that's inside China. And also that's why it's a globalized era, and it's also one of the very important component in the Xi Jinping's part to deliver the common development and also to deliver Belt and Road initiatives. And one of the final objective of those foreign policies in this new era, okay, is to achieve a shared future or common destination.
Okay, now we are end of this. Okay, today, now we are end of our program. So would you like to share something to our audience?
Yes, I'm a frequent visitor to Nepal. I have already seen actually a lot of progress is being made in Nepal here. And of course, seen as a friend of Nepal and the Nepali people, I would really to see that in this new era, in this new time, that both of our two countries and the two peoples can seize the time, can get fully use of the advantages we have to achieve our common development. So that is the very real. And also specifically, I would like to see with the cooperation with China, I would like to see my Nepalese friend can increase your own income and also get a better job and also to to have a better career and a family life.
It was really wonderful time. It was really meaningful conversation with you. Thank you very much for your valuable time and joining with us.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you.
Okay, today we talk about One Belt and One Road, and we try to know more about China and One Belt and One Road and the project which are initiated by the China government for the development of nations, especially like Asia Pacific nations countries like Nepal. Thank you for watching us. Thank you very much. Keep watching ABC Television. Namaste and thank you. Have a good time.